Hi all. Today my video is about a new version of modeling digital trees evolution. If in the first version everything came to spruce trees, now there are new forms of existence that can dominate the world. I don't simulation the evolution of real trees, it's just that it all looks similar, and I use the analogy with the plant world. I model evolution in an abstract way to satisfy my curiosity. In the video, I will talk about a new genome which has become twice larger and led to new forms emerging. We will also analyze the genome of some creatures. The genome now has certain properties that allow the cell to change the active gene or perform one of five commands, and we will consider some of them today. I'm launching a new version of the world. Now it has become five times wider. The whole world can be observed from above the screen. Refer to this gray bar to see which fragment of the world is displayed in the center of the screen. I will restart the world again. I've added an energy display mode. In this mode, you can see how much energy each cell receives. The more yellow the color, the more energy the cells receive. Blue cells get nothing. It is clear that the fewer blue cells in the tree, the better. While the world is developing, I'm going to tell you how I have implemented solar energy distribution. The function has two parameters, solid and levels. In my case, solid is always equal to 3, and I don't touch it. But I dynamically change the levels right during modeling. This variable means the number of cell layers that can potentially receive energy. Let's consider the option when the parameters are equal to 3 and 6. Since levels equals 6, we'll take the top 6 layers of the cells and assign them the numbers from 6 to 1. This will be the first multiplier to calculate the energy amount. Solid equals 3, so let's put 3 layers on top layer and go down. If there is a cell on the current layer, on the next layer, we will decrease the variable by 1. If the layer is empty, then on the next layer, we will increase the variable by 1, but we can't exceed 3. We have gone through all the layers. And now on all layers, where multipliers are positive numbers, we will multiply them and we'll get the amount of how much energy the cell in this layer will receive. I'd like to note that with every move, the cell loses 10 units of energy. Levels equal to 6 is a fairly low level of the sun, but even with it, the trees survive. The most beneficial option is when the cells go in one layer, with gaps between the layers. And here is an example of an unsuccessful option. Only 3 layers will receive energy here. Let's see what's going on in the world. A little over 90 generations have passed. One of the options that appeared is this iron. Using it as an example, we will consider how the updated genome works. The first cell always has the gene number 0 active. According to this, the cell will give 3 offshoots, to the left, up, and to the right. The offshoots with an active gene number 1 will sprout to the right if they can. But with the upper offshoot, it's a little more complicated. Its gene has an activated condition. This is the number 10 in the gene, and also the parameter, number 23. So far, I have introduced 18 conditions. The gene can have a number from 0 to 63, and if the number fits into the range from 1 to 18, it becomes a condition. Condition number 10. If the remaining lifespan of the tree is more than twice the parameter, the data from another gene is used for growth, or a command is performed. The remaining lifespan of the tree is 89. That's more than twice the parameter. This means that the data of the gene number 7 will be used for growth. An offshoot with an active gene number 0 will grow out. The tips of the branches have an active gene number 12. It has a condition related to the amount of energy the tree has. Since it is always fulfilled, the growth data from the first gene is used. The offshoot grows again with an active gene number 12. The result is a cycle that will be interrupted if the energy of the tree becomes less than 900. In order for the whole tree to fit into the screen, we will slightly change the parameter in the gene number 9. Now the condition isn't fulfilled anymore, and the gene number 9 has to use its own data. So, using genetic modification, we got an iron with a low body. Let's see what happens next. The grass appeared, but the grass may be different. True grass and also pseudograss exist. The benefit of the grass is that all cells receive energy. Thus, the grass can exist with a small amount of solar energy. Well, the place for the descendant is actually booked. I have saved the genomes, and we'll figure out what lives here. This species is the most common one. The offshoots are on top. In the previous version, this was impossible. After a while, the seeds disappear and a branch appears, growing to the side. There are also many subspecies. Let's try to dig into the genome. This is how the tree starts growing. All upper offshoots have an active gene number 3. It had to try to sprout to the left and turn into a regular cell. But there is one condition in its gene that says, until the weight of the tree reaches 136, skip the move. This is one of the 5 commands I use for the genome. I lowered the tree a little to get it out of the screen. The tree weight, or the number of cells in the tree, has reached 136. We shall make the next move, and all offshoots with the gene number 3 will turn into ordinary cells together. And here, the branch is growing. Let's run a little experiment. Let's place this tree into an empty world and turn off the mutation. After some time, we see a semblance of grass. This is what I call pseudograss. When seeds fall too close to each other, it stops them from growing, and it all looks like grass. It's probably a good opportunity. It will enable the trees to survive during the period of low energy. Now let's reduce the energy a little. The trees die before reaching their maximum height, but just before death, a single twig fluffs up into a bouquet. Let's look at the genome and see why it's happening. The branch offshoot has an active gene number 12. It says, while the tree has a lot of energy, use the data from the gene number 1 for growth. And the gene number 1 says, grow the right offshoot with an active gene number 12. Since the tree energy lowers, the cycle is broken. And instead of a twig, we get something strange. By the way, this is the same cycle with the same genes that we observed while the branches of the iron tree were growing. So, this tree is a distant ancestor of the iron. Let's see what's coming next. The grass rules the world. All the energy accumulated by a tree is distributed among the seeds of this tree. All grass cells receive energy from the sun, and from generation to generation, huge amounts of energy can be accumulated. Now I have introduced a limit on the amount of energy that a seed can store. Prior to the restrictions, the grass could grow for more than 100 generations, with the sun turned off completely. Here are the first trees that scatter their seeds already during their growth. Well, in the life of the grass, interesting phenomena occur, visible only when examining the genome. Let's start with a tree scattering a seed. A normal growth begins. Let's look at the active gene of this offshoot. It has a condition. If the offshoot is at a height above 16, then it falls off, turning into a seed. This is another command I've added. The tree comes to the end of its life and 17 more seeds remain. By this time, the first seed has already fully grown. But not only a tree can scatter seeds, the grass can do it too. The offshoot with an active gene number 2 will turn into a normal cell. An offshoot with an active gene number 3 will skip its turn for the rest of its life. The offshoot with an active gene number 7 will fall off. It doesn't even need to fall, it immediately gives life to a new plant. More, more, and more. By the time the original plant dies, it will already have 18 great-great-great-grandchildren. I also have a simple true grass. One move, and that's it. It will simply accumulate energy until death. For the sake of the experiment, let's place these two species into an empty world and turn off the mutation. Green grass is scattering seeds. Blue grass propagates in a traditional way. While the blue one was thinking, the green one had already circled the whole world. This is a record-setting result. For every 5 moves, a new plant grows, and 4 cells of the territory are covered. Let's get back to modeling. The trees using a carpet bombardment with seeds have appeared. And here's a plant covering the grass from above. That's the most energy-efficient way to live among the grass. The trees dropping a stream of seeds appear rarely. I've captured its gene and will place it in an empty world. While saving the gene, I have also saved the level of solar energy at which the plant existed. With this level of energy, the seeds lose all their energy in the fall. I'll add some sunshine. The world is populated by pseudograss. These are trees that can't grow because of the dense arrangement, and they grow only because their neighbor has died nearby. Well, now we'll take a look at the plant covering the grass from above. For 2 seeds, the place is already reserved, and a long runner, which will be another 60 cells longer, will help store a large amount of energy. Even at such a low level of the sun, the vast majority of cells of this plant bring 8 units of energy per move. There is also a species that scatters seeds. Whether this makes sense, selection will show. This is what it looks like when modeled. As part of the fight against the grass, I created a fog. When inside, its cells can't receive energy from the sun. Now the height of the fog is 1 cell. I will slowly increase the height of the fog, allowing the trees to adapt to new conditions. I'll try to sharply reduce the fog and see where the tree crown grows. Well, yes. The tree crown will grow where the fog has disappeared. Apparently, the condition for the energy amount received by the offshoot is triggered in the genome. Oh. Well, at least the genome has been saved. Behind the scenes, I've left a command to reduce the lifespan, which leads to the species with a short life cycle appearing. Also, there's a command allowing the branch to adjust its length. The offshoot somehow eats the branch moving along. Besides, I'm planning to experiment with fog, zones with different conditions, and the movement of the sun, when only a part of the world is illuminated. Coming in my next videos. Thanks for your support. That's all for now. Bye, everyone.